This week on TechSpot vCast, nickel allergy showing up in more devices, and this time it's Apple devices. Google says now you can be anybody you want to be. Have a secret you want to share? There's an app for that. And Apple and IBM joined forces. All that and more this week here on TechSpot vCast on YouTube. This is George Price, and welcome to TechSpot vCast show number 22, July 17, 2014. And joining me is my co-host, Rodney Connor. What's going on over there where you're at, Rodney?
Well, trying to sneak a show in while there's no noise going on. We're having a new floor installed today at the house, and had to already delay by an hour recording the show. And occasionally I still hear noise in the background occasionally, so hopefully it doesn't get into the show, but if not, at least you know what it was. Other than that, just another great day in tech paradise.
Okay, Shark, we're going to get this thing rolling. You say iPads have been causing some problems some other mobile devices have caused in the past. I've read a little bit about this, but tell us what's happening.
Well, recently, a story creeped up in the news about a 11-year-old boy in San Diego that recently was treated for an unexplained rash. The reason this was making tech news is because it was pinpointed to possibly be the boy's iPad. Doctors eliminated reasons based on the location and the severity of the rash, and the boy was tested for nickel allergy, or he did test for a nickel allergy after all the other. Allergy testing, if anybody knows anything about it, is a long process, and apparently the boy tested for nickel allergy.
Positive. You say where he was affected. Where on his body did it say where he was affected?
It didn't state. It stated the body all over. The story was geared more towards, the iPad than him, unfortunately. But the doctors tested... after eliminating some cause and reason, the doctors decided to test the boy's iPad. Tested the outside, the backing of the iPad.
The back, okay.
And he uses it daily, is what his parents said. I assume maybe for school. Hopefully, if you're using it every day, I would hope it'd be for school. But anyway, they tested. It did test positive for chemical components. Uh-huh. Excuse me. This is going to be a long show if I can't talk like this. It tested for positive for components of nickel on the back side.
All right.
I guess just to make some sense out of why this story became relative, I guess 25% of tested children in the U.S. Do have a nickel allergy.
Wow.
And, well, there's a lot of iPads and iPhones and, all these eye devices. The release didn't indicate what model of iPod. Of iPad, talking again.
Yeah.
It didn't indicate what model of iPad that it was. However, they did say that the iPad was purchased in 2010. I totally forgot until just now to look up to see what model was released in 2010. I do believe, just off a really quick memory bounce, it should be the iPad 3.
Okay.
Go ahead.
I've seen this come up before, and I really hadn't paid a lot of attention to it, but I don't think it's just Apple devices that's causing this. There's other devices out there that have had the same type, cause people the same type of issue. And I didn't, I too didn't look this up, but this has been kind of an ongoing thing. So this nickel is somehow... in the cases of them, or is it inside the leaking out from the inside?
Well, they tested the backing, the backside of the iPad. They didn't break it down and test the internal parts.
Uh-huh.
So the backside was tested. It tested positive. When Apple was contacted for a comment, spokesperson Chris Gaither was contacted specifically, and he gave no comment. However, in the light side of this, protective cover, say any kind of case or the back cover, that will should isolate the issue just because it is coming directly off of the back. So apparently, Apple kind of partially hinted towards their going to explore this situation, but there's not been much more said other than the story that I just read.
Okay. But again, I had came across this here and there and not really paid a lot of attention to it. But
right.
I don't think it's just Apple. I think it's something to do with the type of item they're using. The device is somehow contains nickel and can cause some people some pretty severe issues with this
right.
kind of thing. So maybe you'll get more on this and we can follow up on this a little bit on down the road. Anything else on this nickel thing?
No, I mean, you mentioned, like you said, it's been in and out for a while.
Mm-hmm.
The iPads now, laptops, cell phones. This isn't anything new. It's just it got approached probably mostly because, well, there's, I think in the WWDC conference, they said there were 500 million iPads.
Yeah.
I think is what that number was.
Yeah.
Don't quote me on that, but I know it's a million, obviously.
Yeah.
I mean,
well,
there's hundreds of millions, we know.
Well, again, you know, I don't think that I had read it was connected with Apple, per se, in the past.
Right.
And I can't remember what devices they were talking about when they said that some people had been affected by this nickel allergy. But perhaps, again, you get some more on this, you can let us know and we can follow up on this.
Absolutely.
All right. I guess you heard about Google Plus.
I heard a little bit about it. The fact that you can pick whatever name you want.
Yeah. Back in a little while back when they was making all this fuss about comments on, let me see here, check something. There you go. You're back full screen.
Oh, there you.
You're back full screen again. I don't know what happened. But when they were making all this fuss about comments on YouTube and connecting that up with Google Plus and blah, 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 all that kind of junk, they said that you had to use your real name on Google Plus,
mm-hmm.
you know, who you are. Well, yesterday they came back and retracted that. Now you can use any name you so desire on Google Plus. And this
maybe they realize that they're like on the tail end of the social network chain.
Yeah, I don't know. They say that some people had shied away from it, from Google Plus, because they didn't want to use a real name.
Right.
Having said that, so now they're going to be like Twitter. Now on Twitter, you don't have to use your real name. You can use it, whatever name that you can find to fit in that block that you put your name in. And,
right.
And so they're now going to be like Twitter and allow anybody to use any name they want to. And this is getting mixed comments back and forth on the Google Plus page, if that makes
right.
sense. It's a Google
right.
Plus, Google Plus page. Anyway, just at last look, I'm going to refresh this and see what 36. They got 3,690 comments on this now. Different people saying this is going to be better, and some people saying this is going to be worse because, you know, they're afraid people come in there and start trashing different people's comments and not really be, you know, find out who they are. But
right.
I guess you still have to verify on Google Plus when you make an account or have an account.
Right, right.
You know, so I don't know that this is going to be any big problem, and YouTubers now can use their YouTube name on Google Plus, and I guess you can only change it about once every 3 months, something like that. So if you want to regress back to whatever name you used in the past, you can change it, and then you can change it again in 3 months. I'm not even going to mess with mine. I'm just going to... Oh.
All right.
We was going in a Rodney Connor and I was in a Skype call here, and all of a sudden a Skype call bumped. So we're trying to figure out what happened, but I think we've covered that Google Plus thing as much as we're going to cover that. So, this is the first time on Skype this has ever happened to us. We've used Skype over a number of, 22 shows now for 22 weeks,
right.
And we've never really had this problem. Rodney, you got a secret you want to share with us here?
Probably not, because then a lot of people will see. if you have heard of the app called Secret.
No.
So I'm going to clarify that so it doesn't get confusing, because Secret is both a verb and a noun. The app called Secret.
Yeah.
Is now a little less secret, to a point. When I first started writing this story up, I was gearing it towards the fact that now the app that doesn't show secrets does, but it actually is a little different.
Okay.
To backtrack a little bit,
right.
When the app was first built, it was built on the process that a user could post an anonymous secret that would share across basically the secret
app.
Social media app, yes.
Okay.
When a user posts a secret via the social network, others will see it. However, they don't see who did or who posted it.
Oh.
The most that they see is where it was posted from.
A city or something, or part of the country,
Basically, the way I understood it, because I've never used it until just a little while ago. I tested it out just to play with it and see and understand.
Okay. All right.
And it was only showing countries. But the way I understood it, the more visible it becomes, which they have a like process, which they have the heart kind of like Instagram.
Okay.
The more hearts that it gets, the more visible it becomes. So I guess the more visual it becomes as far as where it came from specifically.
Uh-huh.
So instead of my post coming from the United States, it would, as it got more popular, would be from Indiana or maybe even possibly Anderson.
Okay.
The process was retooled slightly back. Well, I have a date, but I don't think I posted it in my little notes here.
All right.
Just a few days ago, they announced the release of a couple of additions. One is a new thing called collections, which is basically curated streams. Curated. I can never say that word right. Curated streams of popular secrets about specific topics. Kind of like trending on Twitter, but it's trending secrets, I guess.
This is something like NSA secrets.
Oh, sure. Yeah. I'm sure there'll be a lot of that.
Now, what kind of secrets what kind of things are people posting?
Everything. And I almost took a screenshot, but I didn't want to put it on the show just for, possibility of getting hit mail or hate mail. I saw small things from he doesn't know I love him to I just had to kill her. What? I mean, people, I'm really hoping they were kidding, because surely these people have to understand, although on the public end it's secret, the people behind the program surely can track it down.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, I mean, if the FBI wants to say, hey, who did that? 5 minutes, they've got the answer, I'm sure. But yeah, but anyway, I mean, it's very open. It's not got any kind of standard by any means.
Any number of users that use Secret have secrets are sharing?
Do what now?
Any number of users? How many users are using sharing their secrets?
I didn't see how popular it is. However, where I'm getting at for the change that they made is. You know, originally other users could see the secrets, just not who it was from. Now, they've added where you can log in through Facebook app, which will now link into your Facebook friends.
Okay.
So, you are more likely to see more secrets from them, your friends, your Facebook friends.
Okay.
While remaining completely anonymous is what the CEO stated as a quote. You're still anonymous, however, say if you only have 10 Facebook friends, 3 of which are female, and it's something that's driven behind female, well, you got 3 choices. So it's much less exclusive now where, when I was looking through the list when I first opened it, I was reading secrets from Pakistan, United Kingdom, United States, and it was all over the globe.
Okay.
So it changes, kind of like the Facebook, how they change things as far as based on what they want you to see. This is your choice. If you log in through Facebook, it gives Facebook users the priority.
All right.
Essentially.
Okay.
So, when I originally wrote this, it was a little more of an entertaining story than it is now. However, it is still a tech news, and they are adding the Facebook login to both the iOS and the Android app.
All right.
So I'm going to have to try to test it out and play with it some. When I logged in, I didn't have any Facebook friends that used the app, so it was kind of useless to me other than just reading through other people's through the world. Yeah.
But you found a couple interesting posts on this.
I did. They were intriguing. I mean, most of them were just, blah, blah, blah. You killed someone?
Well, maybe this is the something that what's his name, Snowden, whatever, over in Russia. Maybe that's where he's posting some of his information or something.
Uh-huh. Mr. Snowden.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
You know, I actually heard. It's funny you joke about that, but I heard that he actually has posted on there before. I heard that in a news story one time back when the app first debuted. In fact, I think he may have been involved in the development.
Honestly,
it's all started coming to my head. I may be completely blowing this out and no clue, but after you said that, sparks started going off and I started remembering things.
Yeah, maybe it's something we want to take a look at and see.
I will have to dig a little deeper.
Every once in a while, see what's going on out there that we probably, the secret that we don't know about, maybe we should know about. All right, but that's a free app on Android and iOS only?
Yes, it is. It is for iOS and Android. It is free.
Okay.
And feel free to tell your secrets, I guess.
if you got something you want to share and you don't want to really share it, then you can use secret. To keep it secret, post it, and still secret. All right. We got. I read about this yesterday, just kind of trying to figure out what sense this makes with IBM and Apple.
we'll just start off with the headline. Now, IBM and Apple have joined forces to improve enterprise reach. They announced this Tuesday the 15th.
All right.
That Apple and IBM have joined up to, and this is a quote from Tim Cook, transform enterprise mobility. Basically, the highlights of this situation, because this was down into a lot of business terminology and this and that of we want this for the people kind of thing.
Yeah.
Really, the highlights are that new IBM native apps are basically going to be redesigned for iOS and the IBM cloud services to all work together. The idea behind this is to help each other. This is I'll scratch your back, you scratch mine.
Okay.
Apple is interested in basically improving their enterprise base with iOS, meaning iPads and iPhones.
All right.
And IBM wants to get their business solution software in the same market. They already are in the market, however, there is... Now the BlackBerry has died out. iOS has kind of scooped up the BlackBerry audience.
Okay.
And IBM wants to keep in that realm because IBM was kind of into the BlackBerry portion because they worked together.
Oh, okay.
Now they're trying to recreate that. Essentially, IBM will directly sell iPhones and iPads with IBM apps preloaded and pre-installed for, again, another quote, industry-specific solutions. Meaning they're trying to catch that other 2 or 3% of the Fortune 500 companies that don't already use iPads and iPhones or that need more of a large-scale data algorithm and analytics system.
Okay.
But that's where all the business terms start coming in. Essentially, the bottom line is to put IBM's big data analytics into the hands of the iOS users. You got the two marketers, you got the big business software, and you got the big, I'm talking tonight, it's really bad. You got the big business software and the big business hardware all in one lovely little package. And to finish off the story is a quote in the release from Tim Cook. And what he said was that we're good at building a simple experience and in building devices. The kind of deep industry expertise you would need to really transform the enterprise isn't in our DNA, but okay. It's in IBM's.
Okay. Now, would this be for something like a large company like Boeing Aerospace or something like that? Or they wanted mobile devices for the users to exchange information? But you said analytics in there. What kind of information specifically are they going to be using these Apple IBM devices for?
I like that, the Apple IBM devices. that's good. And just to add in, since we've created our own name for it, IBM actually has a name called IBM Mobile First.
Okay.
Is what they're calling this little program.
All right.
To answer your question, I actually don't have an answer. However, in the story that I got and that was in the press release, they didn't really open up into those small details.
Uh-huh.
They just want to make themselves open and available.
Okay.
Well, IBM has been known. I mean, IBM was the business builder behind the data center and the data.
Right.
Again, that word, analytics. Right. Any kind of data processing
is
theirs. IBM, you know, that's all theirs. Apple has got the hardware part, and they just want to kind of marry them together.
Okay. Well, maybe we can get some more on this down the road and find out. But IBM is strong into, like you say, data and being able to handle large amounts of data. And perhaps it's something that BlackBerry was trying to make more secure environments for exchanging, just like emails, available to other devices. So they let some of that out so companies could implement this within their organization, the BlackBerry ability to have secure exchanges between people. And maybe now with BlackBerry still declining, Apple's looking to IBM to try and capture this market.
Right.
You know. Okay, so
it's one of those where there's so much speculation, so we'll just I keep on it and see what happens.
What exactly is going to happen with this down the road?
Right.
Is this thing in testing now, or what's the deal?
That's the other thing. They did not release any statement of it's available now, we're doing it next month. So maybe the story I got my information from just wasn't clear enough, or maybe that's just the case. Right.
That's
now.
All we got right now.
So,
all right. Well, if you get any more on this, let us know. What do you want to talk about on Kickstarter? I've been kind of trying to figure out what. Go ahead. What about Kickstarter?
Well, you know, I have juggled around for a long time.
You're gone again.
Yeah. I'm switching my screen here.
All right.
I've thought about for a long time of maybe for my weekly app doing Kickstarter, because Kickstarter, I mean, it just as the name declares, Kickstarter is where a lot of these companies, businesses,
yeah.
I'm trying to get my screen to the beginning here. I guess it was where I had it to be when I was playing with it. We'll just close it out and start over. Anyway, back to the Kickstarter demonstration.
Yeah, that's where the potato salad thing took off the other day, and now it's kind of gone. Potato salad's kind of gone bad or something, I think.
Yeah, Kickstarter is meant for the guys that don't quite have the money, but they have the idea.
Yeah.
For either, I'm trying to figure out what this is here on the screen. It must be a book, I'm thinking. You can use it for just about anything that's a business venture, from publishing a book to movie making, technology, gadgetry,
right.
All kinds of cool stuff.
Okay.
And I mean, here's if you're watching the podcast or the YouTube show, here is basically all of the categories, you know, from art, comics, film and video, journalism, publishing, technology, theater. I mean, they're all there. All the main things that business ventures are people that they have the design, the idea, they just don't have the money.
Okay.
My favorite that I almost always am looking through for Kickstarter is technology.
Okay.
Who would have thought? technology category in here has always got some neat stuff, and it also breaks down by subcategory, as you see if you're watching the video portion. I have funded several projects on Kickstarter.
Yes, you said you had.
Well, yeah, one of which is still on its way. They've been in production for a long time. It is, it's called, let's see if it'll bring it up here for me. One of the projects that I've done here is the XY Bluetooth tracking tag.
Okay.
Now, just on this picture here, you see that little teal colored octagon.
Okay.
That is, or pentagon. Oh, no. What are the six? Hexagon, right? But, back to geometry. Anyway, that six-sided shape there, that little tag is only about an inch in total diameter, and it's meant to, you know, put in your wallet, hang on your keys, things like
okay.
that.
Okay, all right,
and
okay.
And it would track Bluetooth-wise with your phone. So anyway, back to the app, that's one of the kind of things that I have funded through Kickstarter.
Okay. Now, and when you were showing us originally the list of categories that you had there, music, technology, on all those were staff picks, right?
No, these categories here, the art, comics, all these, there's I think like 12 of them.
Uh-huh.
These are the categories all together. These
okay.
are all the categories based on the project type.
Okay.
Now, you can pick staff picks. These are the ones
okay.
that are favorited by
all
Kickstarter
right.
staff that they think really are going to go well.
Okay.
They also have a popular tab,
right.
which is pretty self-explanatory.
See that?
The starred tab, that's actually for the user portion. Say if there's some I've looked through and I thought, oh, I'm going to pay attention to that. Maybe I'll fund it later.
Okay.
You can kind of like or favorite it.
Bookmark those kind of.
Right.
Okay.
And then there's the nearby.
Oh.
And it actually finds based on, I don't know what the distance is, and I have not found anywhere in the app where
okay.
to set the distance. But these, oh, hey, you can buy mashed potatoes.
Yeah. I've seen that.
There are some interesting ones on here, I got to say. You can find nearby projects, just like when I showed you this, this one here, the Protest,
right.
is a Christian rock band that I love that's from Alexandria that I
oh.
helped fund their future album.
Okay.
So, apologize, my voice is starting to go a little bit, but anyway, back to the categories.
Yep.
We were looking into technology.
Okay.
And you can go through, and I've spent hours just, oops, somehow I moved. I've spent hours just looking through these different things. And they're so, the neatest thing about them is they're so variant. They go from one side of the spectrum to the other.
Okay.
And this isn't like some crowdfunding type programs where when you meet your goal, you're done. Kickstarter allows you to continue fundraising.
Oh, I misunderstood that. I thought Kickstarter, if you put a goal of $500,000, you had to meet that $500,000 goal within a specific time, or the whole thing was wiped out.
Now that is true. So that's the other end of it. Kickstarter, when a project person, I guess, I don't know, I can't think of who to call them.
All right.
A person wants to start their project, they submit it. Say this one here on the screen now.
Okay.
They submitted originally that they needed $30,000 within a set time period.
Okay.
If the project does not reach the $30,000 within that set time period, all the people that pledged money towards don't get charged any money. That's the thing. Well, actually, some people get in trouble with it. They'll go through and they'll pledge, say, oh, I'll pledge $1,000.
Okay.
You don't actually get charged until the project funds.
Oh.
It only funds itself
okay.
if it makes the goal. So, like this one, for example, it reached the $30,000 goal a while back.
All right.
And it still has 3 days to go. So, it still has three more days to continue bringing money in. That's just money in the bank to increase production
Extra money.
Now, they can choose, the developers can choose, and I've seen it before, say they only want that amount of money. They just need it. They can set it so it stops then.
All right.
But I haven't seen that much often at all. Like this one here, these things here, the earrings.
Yeah.
It's the world's smallest earbuds.
Yeah.
They needed 179 pounds, I think is what that is.
Okay.
And they so far have gathered 884,000. and they still have 7 days to go. But then there's these other projects that, you know, you can set it to like 30, 60, or I think even 90-day projects. Right. And this one's got a ways to go. 250,000 is its goal, and it still has
That may be dead in the water.
The neat thing about these, and this last, my last thing I want to tap on, is let's find something here, like this personal smartphone viewer. I don't know anything about it, but we're going to look at it.
All right.
I haven't looked at it before, I promise, so I'm not not giving any kind of endorsement. So just by looking through this, you decide you like it. Okay. They have what are called basically rewards. You can – or incentives, actually, is what Kickstarter calls it. Based on – see, like this one hasn't had anybody hit these incentives minus just a couple. For different things, you get early bird specials, or like in the case of that XY, that tracking tag.
Yeah.
I got in there quickly, and for like almost nothing compared to the what's going to be retail price, I got one practically for free in the end.
Wow. Okay.
So there are incentives. The quicker you get in, so the idea behind this is if you want to be a fast crowdfunder.
Yeah.
You wanna watch it a lot. If you like to be the guy that does this and says that you helped fund that project, this is something you need to watch a lot because you get a good opportunity to get in and might get some benefits out of it.
Might get some cool stuff cheap.
Absolutely. I mean, there's a lot of people that just fund it just to fund it, and then there's others that are doing it to get the free stuff. We're not free, but they're much cheaper, new age, never before made.
Technology stuff. Or whatever's going on, it can
absolutely,
but it can be a lot of things. I've seen like a boutique in there. So what do you get for boutique? Maybe you get a chair. I don't know a discount card or something. I don't know,
but like this guy here, it's a little wind measuring device that you plug into your iPhone sound port, your headphone port. You get different, you know, idea. The first one here is just simply, I mean, some of these incentives are just down to, we'll send you a signed thank you card.
Yeah.
And then others, like this one here, you actually get the wind meter that they are planning to sell for 40% off the expected retail price. So
that wind,
you do get deals.
That wind thing would be great for perhaps storm chasers if it worked out real well.
Absolutely.
You know? A lot of storm chasers out there, a lot of people doing that.
Absolutely. It's become a big thing.
There's so much stuff out there. Trying to find something that you'd be really interested. But this is just, this app is for iOS and Android?
It is for iOS and Android.
Okay.
And it is free.
Just a way to follow different Kickstarters, see what's going on Kickstarter? Is that basically it?
Yeah, well, I mean, it is fully functioning. I only use it when I'm browsing through to find new projects to fund.
Mm-hmm.
You can also go to Kickstarter.com, do the same thing.
Okay.
I find it easier on the phone, though. It's less distracting.
Okay.
Or the iPad, but any device. But on the computer, you've got ads that you see off to the side and such. So
I've seen some stuff like that.
It gets kind of distracting.
I've seen some stuff like that that it's just actually easier to look at on the phone than it is on the on a computer. But I was confused about Kickstarter. I was thinking, again, like I said, you set an amount, you got to have $100, you got 30 days to get to $100. If you only get $95, you're done.
Right.
But you say they have a continuous funding. That's a different program?
Well, it all works in the same. Basically, by default, a developer can set up so that, say, I want to... By category, Kickstarter's not allowed to do this, but say I could. If I wanted to set up a $200 fund, you and I talked earlier about me getting a new webcam or a new camera for the production.
Right.
I could set up a fund that I need to raise $200, and I'm going to set it to do in 30 days.
Okay.
Say in 15 days I've already hit $200. By default, the program continues to gather money.
For that period of time.
Right.
Okay.
Up to that end of the 30 days.
Right.
Unless I set a setting to it that says once I hit 200, no matter, as long as it's within 30 days, if I hit $200, stop there. You can set it that way.
Okay.
On the other side of it, if like you were saying, say I get up to $199 and I never hit $200 within 30 days, the project fails, you got to start over.
Okay. But there is no, like, is it Patreon or is it a continual funding type thing?
Right. Patreon, and we actually, I have set up Patreon in case anybody wants to be generous enough to donate money to this cause.
Right.
It is on our website, by the way. There's a shameless plug there. Patreon is, that's exactly what it is. It's a continuous Patreon. I think you can set it up so that, like, for an example, if someone was interested in funding or sponsoring our show,
right,
you can set it up so that they automatically are paying out so much money for every episode that is released, or you can do it monthly or weekly or whatever you want to do.
Okay, but you set up the amount that the sponsors set up the amount they want to pay, right, on
right.
Patreon? So
right.
If it's a dollar a month or 50 cents a month or $100 a month,
right.
They select
you, you still set a fundraising goal.
Okay.
However, that's just kind of a guideline.
Okay. All right. Well, I'll have to check that Kickstarter app out and see if there's anything in there I'm interested in following along, maybe helping out a little bit. Anything else on this?
I think that's it.
All right. Well, it's been a great show. And what you got planned for the rest of the day?
Well, I got to hurry around and get ready to go to work. Tonight's, this is the week that I go to work to work this evening. So
yeah, yeah.
Just a couple days, and then I'll be off for the weekend.
Oh.
I will be receiving another device from AT&T. However, I have not got any confirmation yet.
Oh, you just did a review on an AT&T device, and that looked pretty cool.
Yeah, it was a little harder to do for me because, in all honesty, the phone, to me personally, was a little less exciting.
It was a rugged phone, though. It's for one somebody would take working out on job sites or going
right.
jogging or some kind of physical activity. Phones like that, some people have those for socket phones.
Right.
You know, where they take them out to their job site or working or doing construction or whatever they're doing, and then they come home and they have another phone for the evening phone.
Right.
You know.
I've heard of that before.
Yeah.
But yeah, the phone, to defend what I'm going to mention here, was less exciting than my first one. I've done two phones.
Yeah.
The one was that really cool curved phone.
Right.
And then this one was the rugged. They're both still very, you know, equivalently awesome phones. They performed great. But I had someone comment on my YouTube video that I read it just as if I read it from the AT&T review, which just out of my defense, I don't read any or watch any of that stuff
okay.
prior to doing my okay. review because I don't want that to happen.
Yeah.
I just happened to, you know, I found the same stuff that they talk about.
Well, it's the same phone. I mean, you're going to find
right.
the same stuff they find. But sometimes,
right.
sometimes on reviews, I will look at some other reviews to see if there's anything that they might mention that I might have not thought about, or to see if I want to say, yeah, you know, that's correct, or yeah, well, maybe that's not correct. So what are you getting next time? You have any idea?
No clue.
No clue.
I'm vouching up for the I'm still hoping for an Amazon Fire phone or whatever it is they call them.
Yeah, that'd be cool. All right. Well, our next show is TechSpot 23. Is that correct?
Yep.
And that's
number 23.
And that's going to be July 24, 2014. And you can find us on YouTube, TechSpot vCast on YouTube, and find our podcast and video podcast. And we'll put links down below to where you can find those podcasts and how you can hook up with us on Twitter and contact us if you got something you'd like us to talk about or any questions.
Absolutely.
That's contact us at TechSpotVCast.com.
It is.
It is. All right.
It is. And always keep an eye on the TechSpotVCast.com website. I've been working hard to get it more of a functioning website.
Yeah.
It's getting closer. We
yeah.
have a forum now also.
Yeah.
I'm hoping to get somebody on the forum.
Okay.
It's
yeah.
just, it's you know, the link is on the website or it's TechSpotVCast.com/forum.
Okay.
Good thought.
I'm sure they will. It's just going to take a little time. We haven't been doing this a long time. It's going to be our 23rd week next week. So we haven't been doing this like for years. So it's,
right.
You know, it'll happen. All right. Anything else?
I think that's it for this week.
All right, Rodney. I hope you have a good one, buddy.
All right, you too. We'll see you next week.
All right, bye-bye.